From the coolness of the garden to the chaos of the fall, when we saw the Red Sea parted and Jericho's tumbling walls, our love was leading us to freedom. You were teaching us your song. Through every page of history, you're right where you belong. From the beginning to the ending, you're the center of. Prophets to the virgin birth, the one who healed the blind man was the king that came to serve. And on a cross you bore my burden, took my sin down to the grave. And on that Sunday morning, you rolled the stone away.
With a wild love, a wild love. love to awaken us. Oh, the King has come, the King has come with a wild love, a wild love. For your kingdom come, breathe revival. Let the darkness run, King of heaven. Come and fill this place with your presence. Let our hearts awake, we are desperate. For your kingdom come, breathe revival. Let the darkness run.
All right, all right. Well, good morning. We are super excited that you're here. My name is Josh. If I haven't met you yet, we're so glad that you're here. If you're joining us on Facebook Live, man, super excited you guys are joining us online. If you're a guest with us for the first time, I want to say a special welcome to you as well and just kind of give you a rundown of the morning. Here in just a minute, Carol and our worship team are going to continue to lead us in worship through music, and we want to encourage you to take full advantage of that opportunity to express your love to God. And then our lead pastor, Doug, is going to come up and share a message from God's Word in our series that we're calling Midtown U, and we are excited about the morning. Whenever you came in, you should have received a worship guide that looks like this. In the worship guide, there's a place for you to take notes during the message. I want to encourage you to do that. Also, you'll notice there's some discussion questions at the end of the notes. The reason why we put those in there is so that you can take the message that you hear today with you this week and have some spiritual conversations with people in your life. So take advantage of that opportunity to do that, okay? If you're joining us online, you can click that watch tab on our website and you can download your worship guide there as well. Now, inside your worship guide, there's a connection card. If everybody would, take out that connection card and go ahead and start filling out the front of that card. Those of you online, you can go to our website and click the Connect tab, and there's an online connection card we'd love for you to fill out as well. So go ahead and click your pin open and start filling that out. Give us some basic information about yourself. If any of those boxes there apply to you, check those boxes. You'll notice we're asking for just some basic contact information. The reason why we're asking for that is if you check something on the back of the card, we'll know how to get you the information that you need. If you're a guest with us for the first time, we'd like to send you something in the mail this week. So thank you for providing that contact information. We promise not to share that with anybody. If you have your phone, go ahead and take your phone out. Click it over on silent if you don't mind. And if you're a social media person, check in on Facebook. If you're joining us on Facebook Live, go ahead and share that live feed. And listen, if God speaks to you during the message or during the music, and share that with people on social media. Kind of let people know what's going on in your life, how God's moving in your life today. That would be great. A lot of people show up here for the first time because of the things that you post. So thank you for doing that. Last thing on the front of the card, let us know how you heard about us. If that was online or maybe a friend invited you, write that person's name down so we can make that personal connection today. On the back of your card, you can request some information about us. There's ways you can serve here in Midtown. There's some upcoming events and Bible studies you can sign up for. All those things are designed to move all of us towards God's best together. So take advantage of those opportunities, okay? One last thing on your card. Let us know how we can pray for you this week. And if you're praising God for something in your life, please share that with us so we can celebrate along with you. Now, when we dismiss, you can drop this card in one of the baskets in the back of the room. We'll have ushers back there holding the basket. Drop this card in one of those baskets. Unless you're a guest with us for the first time, we have a gift that we would like to give you. And the reason why we're doing that is just a way for us to say thank you for being our guests. We know you could be a lot of places this morning, but you chose to be here. And man, we consider that an honor, so don't forget to do that. Instead of dropping your card in the offering basket, take your card out those double doors to that table where you picked up your worship guide. One of our volunteers will be there to give you a gift as you go. All you have to do is hand them your connection card, okay? Also, you'll notice in your worship guide there are some offering envelopes. Man, we appreciate and we're grateful for the faithfulness of our members and regular attenders to worship God through giving. Scripture talks about how the local church is a way for us to give back to God. So thank you for doing that. If you're a guest with us, we don't expect you to give unless you just want to do that. And don't forget, there's a giving option on our website. Just click that Give tab to worship God by giving there. When you dismiss, you can drop those offering envelopes in one of the baskets as well, okay? One last thing. Everybody say Palooza.
Palooza.
That's what I'm talking about. October 10th is Midtown Palooza over at our new property on the corner of Boone and Alcoa. This is going to be a fun Sunday. Our two services don't always get to hang out together because they're two separate services, which makes sense. So you don't get to see those people and they don't get to see you, but at these type of events, we're all together and we're going to celebrate how good God is. We're going to feed you lunch. We're going to have a worship service there with Carol and the worship team. Doug's going to teach a message from God's word. It's going to be an awesome day. We're really praying that we get to baptize people on that Sunday. There's going to be games for your family, all kinds of awesome things. But listen, we need you to register. So on the back of your card here, if you haven't already, register you and your family. And we need a ton of volunteers to pull off this event. So you can also volunteer. Any of those things kind of jump out at you that you'd like to help with, check those boxes. When we dismiss, you can drop this in the baskets on your way out, okay? I want to ask you a question. Are you excited to be here?
Yeah.
That's what I'm talking about. Well, listen, we're excited to be here, okay? And listen, maybe you're not excited to be here. Maybe this morning has been a wreck for you. I don't know. Maybe you came in here with a lot of sort of, you know, you can't take a breath and your mind's all over the place. Your kids have been all over the place. And whatever the case may be, whether you're excited to be here or getting here was super stressful, we're glad you're here, okay? And God has you here for a reason. So here's what we want to encourage you to do. Let's pray together and take this opportunity to ask God to kind of settle you down and to be ready for what he has for us today, okay? Well, let's pray together. God, we're grateful for the morning. And as I just mentioned, God, I don't know what everybody came in here with today, but you do. And so, God, I pray that we would take this opportunity to kind of surrender those cares or concerns or anxieties or stress, to give those things over to you and not take them back, but give them to you because you ask us to do that. God, we know that, as I mentioned, you have us here for a reason, and I'd hate for any distraction of the day that we've had so far getting here to cause us to miss what you have for us. So I pray that you would clear our minds, settle our hearts. It's an honor to worship you, so I pray we don't miss that opportunity. And God, we are grateful to be able to sit under the teaching of your word today. So God, speak to us in a way that changes us from the inside out. And we want to thank you in advance for what you're going to do. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, let's stand up and worship together.
We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place, and we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. Oh, 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 we shout out your praise. Oh, oh, oh. We sing to the God who heals. We sing to the God who saves. We sing to the God who always makes a way. 'Cause he hung upon that cross, then he rose up from the grave. My God, still rolling stones away. Yeah. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise.
Come on, Midtown, shout out his praise. Yeah. 'Cause we were the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by his grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. By the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by his grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise.
There's joy in the house
there
of the Lord.
Joy in this house.
There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet.
Oh, yeah.
Gonna shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We're gonna shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We're gonna shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord.
About joy. You may be thinking, you know, Carol, I just don't have it this morning. I don't have that joy. You don't know what I'm going through. You haven't seen my bank account. You haven't met my family. And you know what? That's okay. God knows this morning. And God is here to bring you that breakthrough, to bring you that miracle, that answer. We just believe. We just trust his word this morning. He's going to bring that breakthrough. I just know it. So no matter how you came here this morning, this first line says, the odds may be stacked against you, but with God, the odds are in our favor. Amen? Come on, let's join in worship this morning. Yeah. The odds stacked against me. I'm surrounded on all sides. But I heard you can part the waters. So in your name, come and turn the tides. Do it, Lord. I'm staring at this mountain. There's no chance of getting through. But I heard they could melt before you. So in your name, I'm asking it.
The power of the cross, not ours, but yours, Lord.
Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You can be seated.
You're glad you're here, aren't you? Yes, yeah, right on. Look at somebody close to you and say, man, I'm glad you're here. Tell somebody you're glad to see them today. Hey, my name is Doug. I haven't met you yet. So glad that you're joining us here in person. Those who are joining us on Facebook Live, welcome. We're in a series called Midtown U, Midtown University. We started back several weeks ago when school started, and what we're doing is we're kind of going back and looking at some things that all of us have in our lives, some things that all of us deal with in our lives, and learning what the Bible has to say about those so that we can experience God's best in those areas. And we talked about how we experience God's best in our relationship with Him. We talked about knowing our purpose in life. We talked about relationships. We talked about emotions and feelings. We talked about a lot of stuff. And you can always go back and find these on our website, on our YouTube channel, or on Facebook as well. Today, we're continuing with that same kind of thought, something that all of us deal with, something that all of us kind of struggle with from time to time. And today, I want to help you understand how you and I can experience God's best in regard to our resources. Now, listen, I said resources, and immediately some of you went, you know what he's about to do, don't you? You know, the reason you don't come to church, the reason you quit going to church, and you watch it online sometimes every once in a while, is because all the preacher does is talk about what? Money. All right, that's all the preacher. And so when I said resources, some of you immediately went there. Well, are we going to talk about money today? Yes, unashamedly, I will stand before you and we'll talk about money today, but I want you to understand something more important. When I say resources, here's what I'm talking about. When I say resources, I'm talking about your time, I'm talking about your abilities, and yes, your money and your stuff. Or in other words, you may have heard it said like this: today we're going to talk about our time, our talents, and our treasure. Or as I like to say, we're going to talk about our schedule, our skills, and our stuff. Because, here's why. Let me tell you why this is so important. The Bible says a lot about this stuff, okay? And I think it's important for us to understand that the way we allocate our resources really does determine how well we experience God's best in our life. You agree with that statement? The way we deal with our resources has a huge impact on how we experience God's best in our life. Because these things affect everything else. Think about this. The way you schedule and handle your time affects every part of your life, right? Your marriage, your family, your job, your money, it affects everything. The way you use your skills, your abilities, the way you employ those things in your life, it impacts every other part of your life. The way you use your stuff, your possessions, and your money, it impacts all of our life. So, this just makes sense, okay? If we want God's best in every part of our life, we should probably figure out what God has to say about our resources and how we can use those resources to experience God's best in our life as well. Making sense? You with me so far? This means yes. This means no. That blank stare means, you know, I got here early and the first service went really long. And I'm a little concerned about, you know, beating the Methodist to lunch and kind of thing, right? We got this, okay? You listen fast. We can make this happen. Let's look at what the Bible says. If you have your Bible, open it to Matthew 25. I want to show you a really, really cool story. Matthew is the first book of the New Testament. So if you go about three quarters of the way back in your Bible, you'll find Matthew, Mark, Luke, then John. Matthew 25, there's this really great story that Jesus told regarding how we use our resources. Now, I want us to learn some things from this story today that will help us experience God's best in every part of our life as we learn how to use our resources well. Matthew chapter 25, we're going to start at verse 14. Now, Jesus is speaking here. You know how I know it's Jesus, right? It's written in red in my Bible. That means it's Jesus. You ready? Here we go. Matthew 25, 14. Again, the kingdom of heaven can be illustrated by the story of a man going on a long trip. He called together his servants and he entrusted the money to them, his money to them while he was gone. He gave five bags of silver to one, two bags of silver to another, and one bag of silver to the last. Listen to this. Dividing it in proportion to their abilities. Then he left on his trip. Now watch this. This translation of the Bible says bags of silver. A lot of translations of the Bible use the word talent. He gave this person 5 talents, this person 2 talents, this person 1 talent. A talent, don't think of talent as in, you know, I can juggle, yeah, da, 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 da. Not that, okay? But a talent in those days was just as a unit of measure. So it could have been a measure of silver. It could have been a measure of gold. It could have been a measure of something else incredibly valuable. We don't know. The point is this. Everybody got something of value. Everybody was given something of value. And it was given to them by their master according to their abilities. In other words, the master knew that this person could handle 5, this person could handle 2, this person could handle 1. Everybody got something. Before we go any farther, I want you to hear this, okay? One of the things that will set you free in the area of your resources, your time, your talent, and your treasure is this. Quit comparing yourself to everybody else. Stop it. God has given you what He has given you for a reason. You've heard me say this before. God's never going to entrust me with lots and lots of money because I don't think I would handle it right. And guess what? God knows that. So He don't. My wife handles it. Sometimes she gives me $1 and sometimes she doesn't. Usually she doesn't. You follow me so far? So everybody's got something. Let's go back to our story. Everybody has something. They're supposed to take care of it while the boss is out of town. Let's pick up our story in verse 16. The servant who received the 5 bags of silver began to invest the money and earned 5 more. The servant with 2 bags of silver also went to work and earned 2 more. But the servant who received the 1 bag of silver dug a hole in the ground and hid his master's money. Verse 19, after a long time, the master returned from his trip and called them to give an account of how they used their money. Now the servant to whom he had entrusted 5 bags of silver came forward with 5 more and said, Master, you gave me 5 bags of silver to invest. I have earned 5 more. Listen to this, verse 21. The master was full of praise. Well done, my good and faithful servant. You have been faithful in handling this small amount, so now I will give you many more responsibilities. Let's celebrate together. Big time party for what's happened here. Verse 22. The servant who had received the 2 bags of silver came forward and said, Master, you gave me 2 bags of silver to invest, and I have earned 2 more. Verse 23, the master said, Well done, my good and faithful servant. You have been faithful in handling this small amount, so now I will give you many more responsibilities. Let's celebrate together. Then the servant with the 1 bag of silver came and said, Master, I knew you were a harsh man, harvesting crops you didn't plant and gathering crops you didn't cultivate. I was afraid I would lose your money, so I hid it in the earth. Look, here is your money back. Verse 26 says, but. That's very ominous, isn't it? Dun, dun, dun. Look what happened. The master replied, you wicked, lazy servant. If you knew I harvested crops I didn't plant and gathered crops I didn't cultivate, why didn't you deposit my money in the bank? At least I could have gotten some interest on it. Then he ordered, take the money from this servant and give it to the one with the 10 bags of silver. To those who use well what they are given, even more will be given, and they will have an abundance. But from those who do nothing, even what little they have will be taken away. Now throw this useless servant out into utter darkness, where there is weeping and gnashing of teeth. Now you're really happy to be here, right? So here's what we want to do today. We don't want to be that guy, right? We don't want to be the one that got cast out, that got rebuked by his master. There are tons of things we could learn from this story. And maybe someday we'll just do a whole bunch on this story. But today I want to show you 2 things we can learn from this story that will help us use our resources in such a way, watch this, that we honor and glorify God and experience his best as well. You with me? Let me show you how this works. A couple of lessons we can learn. The first lesson we learn is this. We need to know, what does God say about our resources? What is it that God says about our resources? There's 3 things I want you to grab a hold of this morning as far as what the Bible and God says about resources. Number one is this. Write it down. We must be good stewards of our resources. Write that down. We must be good stewards of our resources. Now, what is a steward? A steward, very simply, is this. A steward is a person who is put in charge of somebody else's stuff in order to take care of it and use it to benefit the owner. A steward is a manager of someone's stuff, and their job is to use that stuff to benefit the owner. How does that relate to us? God says, I have given you resources, time, talent, and treasure. I want you to be a good steward, manager of those resources. Use that well. Why? To bring me honor and glory. Because the Bible teaches when we do that, God pours his blessings into our life. Let's go back and look at this cool verse from our story. Matthew 25, 23. The master said, well done, my good and faithful servant. You have been faithful in handling this small amount, so now I will give you many more responsibilities. Let's celebrate together. We must manage our resources, understanding that they are from God, they belong to God, and when we use them for his glory, he blesses us for that. His purpose is accomplished, and we experience his best. But there's another really important thing you need to see, and that's number two, okay? This is incredibly important. It's not your stuff. Write it down. It's not your stuff. Your stuff is not your stuff. Your resources are not yours. They do not belong to you. The time you've been given, the talent you've been given, the treasure you have been given, it's not yours. Everything we have comes from God. How do we know that? The Bible teaches us. 2 Corinthians 4, 7, you see what it says? For what gives you the right to make such a judgment? What do you have that God hasn't given you? And if everything you have is from God, why boast as though it were not a gift? Everything you have, those clothes you're wearing, God's. Well, no, my wife went and bought this shirt for me and told me to wear it today, and so I did. So, no. Well, where'd your wife come from? Oh, she's an angel from heaven. See, God. Dog, she's not here. She was in first service, and I didn't say that. Well, your car you're driving. No, Doug, I worked really hard for my car. I worked really hard at my job to make money and to grow my business, to have the car I have and the house I have and provide for my family. Way to go. Good for you, buddy. Who blessed you with those talents? Who blessed you with that knowledge? Who blessed you with the ability to do those things? God. Everything, your husband, your wife, I know ladies, some of you are like, but trust me on this one, okay? Your spouse, your children, and we really go on that one, right? But yes, everything comes from God. Watch this. God created, God built it, God made it, God provided every bit of it, and now he says, hey, I want you to take this, and I'm going to give to you according to who you are and who I created you to be. According to who you are, who I created you to be, and the purpose I have for your life. That's how I'm resourcing you. Now please use this to accomplish my plan and purpose. Does that change the way you think about your stuff just a little bit? Does that change the way you think about how you use your time? Does that change the way how you think about how you use your abilities, your talents, your skills, or your possessions or your money? It should, because it's God's. And God says, I'm going to let you use this, but I need you to use it wisely for my glory to accomplish my purpose. Here's the third thing. Resources are given so that we can give. Resources have been given to us so that we can give. All right, see if you can follow this with me. You ready? So if we're going to use God's stuff to accomplish God's purpose, that makes sense, right? We're going to use the stuff that God gave us to accomplish his purpose. We have to give of our resources in order for that to happen. That just makes sense, right? So God has given you your schedule, your skills, your stuff. And if I want to use that for his glory, to honor him, to accomplish his purpose so that I experience his best in my life out of obedience to him, out of faith in him, then it just makes sense that I'm going to have to give my time. I'm going to have to give my skills, my abilities. I'm going to have to give my stuff and my money. In order for this to happen, we have to be willing to let it go. That one servant that went and hid his stuff, he failed miserably because he refused to give. He didn't even give it to the bank. He held on to it because he was so afraid. You and I have to come to the point that we understand this morning. Everybody has something to give. Everybody. We all have time. In fact, that's the only thing that we're all equal on. Did you realize that? We all have the same amount of time. Every day you have the same amount of time. Yes, we'll live to different ages, but every day we all have the same time. You have skills, talents, abilities given from God, and you have stuff. Some people have lots of stuff. Some people don't have lots of stuff. But everybody has some. And if we are going to experience God's best in our resources, we must be willing to give of those. Now, here's where some people do this. Some people go, gotcha. No problem. I've got money. I don't have a lot of time. So I'll throw a little money out there every once in a while and we'll call it good. Okay? All right. Some say, well, I don't have a lot of money. I do have a little time. And so I'll volunteer here or there once in a while, but I'm not going to give my money because I don't have enough to give. Or some say, well, I have this talent or this ability or this skill, but quite honestly, I don't have a lot of time or a lot of money, and so I don't know that I'm going to be able to do that, but I tell you what I can do. Once in a while, when the children's ministry or the student ministry or the church needs this, I can go and I can do these kinds of things, but I'm not going to give my money or my time. Right? I don't think it works that way. I think that everyone has time, talent, and treasure, and everyone must be willing to give some of their time, talent, and treasure to accomplish God's purpose. I believe that that's true. Now, you remember me telling you that I will never give you my opinion, I will always show you what the Bible says, or when I give you my opinion, I'll say that's just my opinion? This is not one of those. I believe the Bible teaches that we all should give of all of our resources, our time, our talent, and our treasure. Let me show you why. Look at these verses. You ready? Proverbs 3, 27 through 28. Do not withhold good from those who deserve it when it is in your power to help them. What does that mean? In your power to help them means you have the time or the talent or the treasure. Covers all three. If you help your neighbor, if you can help your neighbor now, here comes the time one again, don't say, well, I'll come back tomorrow and I'll help you then. No, if you have the time, you're to use it. So this verse covers all three. Galatians 6:10, look what it says. Therefore, whenever we have the opportunity, what is that? Time. We should do good to everyone. What does that involve? Your talent, possibly your treasure, especially those in the family of faith. Acts 2, 44 through 45. This is the very first church of ever, okay? First church of ever in the book of Acts. All the believers met together in one place, shared everything they had. They sold their property and possessions and shared the money with those in need. What is that talking about? It's talking about your stuff, your possessions, and your money. So you see, in each one of these examples, we understand that God is saying, I want you to give, and I want you to give of all your resources. Some of your money, some of your time, some of your talent. You may not be able to give as much as somebody else. Doesn't matter. You may not be able to give as much time as somebody else. Doesn't matter. You may not have certain talents or skills that other people. Doesn't matter. The Bible tells us that we must be willing to give. In order to be a wise steward, a good steward, we must be willing to give to accomplish God's plan and purpose. And I don't understand this, but for some of us, giving is so stinking hard. Have you noticed that? It's just hard. No matter what you're talking about, your time, your talent, or your treasure. I'm convinced that the reason it's so difficult for so many people to give of their time, talent, and treasure is because, quite honestly, we're just so stinking selfish. I want to use my time for me. I want to use my ability for me. I want to use my money for me and my family to benefit me. some of us, we don't give because we miss out on the fact that God says, hey, I've given you this stuff, and so because God gave it to me, it's mine, and I should use it in the way I want. Well, we just established that, no, God gave it to you, but it's His, and it should be used for His glory. And I think the reason some people struggle with giving so badly is because they miss this spiritual principle. We are blessed in order to be a blessing to other people. You have been given to so that you can give to. God never intended that we keep what He's given for ourselves. We are blessed in order to be a blessing to other people. How do we know that? Because that's what Jesus said. Let's go back to the book of Acts, chapter 20, verse 35. The writer of the book of Acts says, I have been a constant example of how you can help those in need by working hard. So guess what? Use your skill. Use your ability. Use your time. Work really hard. Why? To bless other people. He goes on to say this, you should remember the words of the Lord Jesus. Jesus said, it's more blessed to give than to receive. You ever said that? When you got a horrible gift at Christmas and somebody looks at you and goes, well, just remember, it's more blessed to give than receive. And you're like, oh, shut up, right? It's the worst gift I've ever gotten. I got a picture frame one time from Nancy's uncle. It was in college. What do I do with a picture frame? Didn't even have a picture in it. It had some advertising. Stupid. Anyway, sorry, I'm back. Well, just remember, it's more blessed to give than receive. Jesus said that, and it's true. So, if I'm called to be a good steward, then I have to realize my stuff is never going to fulfill me. If you are counting on your resources to fulfill you, you will forever be disappointed. Because it just ain't going to happen. You know why? It was never intended to. That was never the point. God says it was never intended for you to gather stuff to make you happy and make you fulfilled. You're given stuff in order to give to others. And that's where fulfillment happens. So, here's the second lesson we can learn from this story that Jesus told today. How do I become a good steward? What does it mean to be a good steward? And there are three things I think need to happen in order for us to be a good steward today. I want you to, we're going to hit these quickly. You ready? The first one is this. It requires devotion. It requires a devotion. You know what devotion means, right? Devoted to, in love with, committed to. It requires a devotion to God. When you are devoted to God, when you have a love for God and a love for God's purposes, you will use your resources to accomplish His purpose, right? If I'm in love with God and I love what He's doing and I love His purpose and plan for my life, then I'm going to use my resources. That's where it's going to flow because devotion directs your resources. What you're devoted to gets the most of your resources. Now stop and let that settle on you for a second because that hurt, didn't it? What you're devoted to demands the majority of your resources. So we must have a devotion to God. We must have, watch this, we must have a devotion, a love for other people. If you're going to be a good steward of what God has given you, you must have a love for other people. Why? I don't like people. I know. It's hard, isn't it? People. They're the worst. I hear people all the time, man, I wish I had a job where I didn't have to deal with people. I don't think it exists. The closest one I found is an OR nurse. She loves her job because the patients are asleep. She didn't have to deal with them. I'm like, that's genius. I love that. But you got to deal with your coworkers. So, but God loves people. How do we know that? He sent Jesus to die for them. God gave everything for people, including me and you. So when our devotion lines up with God's devotion, we have a love for Him, we will have a love for people, and we will have a love for His church. You will use your resources in a way that honors God when you have a devotion to God and a love for people and a love for God's church. When you love God's church, your assets, your resources will be allocated in a way that helps grow the church. Why? so that God's kingdom is expanded. That's our job. Now hear me, when I say the church, I'm not just talking about Midtown Church. Although I think the Bible's pretty clear that we should give to the church where we attend, where we are. But God says, if you love me, you'll love my purpose, you'll love the things I love. Guess what God loves? He loves people, and he loves his church. In fact, I believe that the way you allocate your resources is a really good indicator of your love for God. And if that hurts, I'm sorry. I think the way we allocate our resources is a really good indicator of our love for God. And to be a good steward that honors God and accomplishes his purpose through our resources, we must have a devotion to him. Because when we are devoted to him, everything changes. When we are devoted to him, everything changes. Think about this. When you put your faith in Jesus, when you accepted Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, you came to that point that you understand, man, I'm a sinner, and my sin separates me from God, but God loved me so much that he sent Jesus to die on the cross. He paid for my sin so I wouldn't have to. That's love. That's devotion. And when you, by faith, receive that. Now, by the way, if you've never done that, it'd be a great place to start today. We're all sinners, all of us. We're all separated from God by our sin. He loved every one of us so much, he sent Jesus to die on the cross for our sin so that we could accept him by faith, be forgiven, have eternal life in heaven. But everything changes. When you have Jesus, everything changes. Your whole heart changes. The Bible says it like this in 2 Corinthians 5:17. This means anyone who belongs to Christ has become a new person. The old life is gone and a new life has begun. Everything's new. And it's shown in the way you allocate your resources, by a true devotion to God. Here's the second thing. Being a good steward requires a discipline. Being a good steward not only requires devotion, but discipline. Now let me explain what discipline is, okay? Discipline is doing what you ought to do even when you don't want to do it, right? Discipline is doing what you're supposed to do even when you don't want to do that. Discipline is eating one Oreo, not one sleeve of Oreos. Amen? Discipline is eating one cinnamon roll, not three or four cinnamon rolls. Discipline is going to the gym even though you don't really want to go to the gym and there's a ball game on that you'd rather watch. Discipline is getting up and going to church in the morning even though you were up late last night. Now, I saw that yawn. Thank you. Right? Way to go. That's discipline. Do what you know you should do, not always what you want to do. And in order for me to be a wise steward, a good steward, and accomplish God's plans with my resources and experience God's best in my resources, it requires discipline. And here's what I know about discipline. The discipline has to be developed. It has to be developed. It does not come natural. None of us are naturally disciplined. We have to develop it. And it takes time to develop good habits with your resources. Discipline has to be intentional. In other words, I have to be intentional with my schedule. I have to be intentional with my skills. I have to be intentional with my spending of my resources, right? And some of us are just all over the place with our schedule. Some of us are all over the place with our spending habits. In fact, I was talking with a guy not long ago about this, and he was really concerned because his wife has a spending problem. I mean, she just spends, 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 spends. I said, oh man, I'm sorry, I'll be praying about that with you. And he said, well, I think I got it figured out. Her credit card was stolen. I was like, oh my goodness, are you serious? Yeah, it was stolen, but I didn't report it. Oh, what do you mean you didn't report it? Is somebody using it? He goes, oh yeah, I see there's somebody's using it. I said, well, why would you not report it? He said, well, they're not spending nearly as much as she did, so. Now ladies, for the right price, I will tell you if your husband told me that story. So, and I ain't cheap, but I can be bought. All right, here we go. So what do I do with that? What do I do with all that? Understand that discipline has benefits for now and eternity. This is really cool. When you learn to discipline yourself in your with the way you allocate your resources, obvious benefits right now, right? But it also benefits eternity. The Bible says it like this. 1 Timothy 4:8, physical training is good, but training for godliness is much better. Why? Because it promises benefits in this life and the life to come. Boom. So, how do I develop discipline? Let me give you a few examples, okay? The first thing I would tell you is this. If you want to develop discipline and the allocation of your resources, first thing I would encourage you to do is attend our spiritual gifts class next Sunday and figure out how, as a Christian, God has gifted you in certain ways. Your talents, your skills, your abilities, some of those come from God as spiritual gifts. Watch this quick video.
Good morning, Midtown!
Yeah. Anything to say?
No. Yeah, I think that's it.
Good morning, Midtown. My name is Shannon, and this is my wife, Amy.
Hello.
And we want to invite you to the upcoming Spiritual Gifts class. This class is designed to give you a 30,000-foot view of spiritual gifts and how you can utilize those gifts in your everyday life to live God's best, and how you can recognize those gifts in other people. You got anything?
That's it.
And the air conditioning works well in the mill.
You're welcome.
Listen, if you don't know Shannon and Amy, you're in for a treat, okay? And it's a fantastic class that will help you develop discipline and allocation of your resources. Here's another thing that will help you learn how to say no. Let's practice together on three. Ready? One, two, three. No. See, some of you smart alecks out there. The quicker you learn to say no, the more disciplined you become in the allocation of your resources. Ladies, please listen to me. Mommies, look at me and listen. I love you so much. And I really want to help you in an important way today. You ready? You don't have to do everything. You just don't have to do everything. And the quicker you learn how to say no to certain things, the better off you're going to be. I got another one for you. Your children don't have to do everything. The quicker you figure that out, the more you're going to be set free in the discipline you have in allocating your resources. Here's another one. You need to have a budget for your finances and stick with it. Ooh, I'm sorry. I wasn't supposed to use the word budget. I know, that's a dirty word. Sorry. The politically correct way, I'm supposed to say it this way. You must develop a spending plan, okay? That sounds way better than budget, right? You have to have a spending plan. Live below your means. Don't go into debt. That requires discipline. But doing those things will help you develop your discipline so that you become a good and wise steward of the resources God has given you. A devotion, a discipline, last one, a decision. When it all boils down, being a good steward really is a matter of making a decision. You have to decide if this is what you're going to do or not. You have to decide how you're going to give your time, your talent, and your treasure. You have to decide where you're going to use your time, your talent, your treasure. You must decide in which ways, how, when, and where you're going to allocate your schedule, your skills, and your stuff. The Bible makes this abundantly clear in 2 Corinthians 9:7. Look what it says. You must each decide in your own heart how much to give. Now, press pause. Are you Bible scholars out there that are going, well, Doug, this is actually talking about the collection of money that was being taken for the church in Jerusalem. This really doesn't have anything to do. I know that. I get it. This is talking about money specifically, but this principle applies across the board. You must each decide in your own heart how much of your time, talent, and treasure you're going to give to accomplish God's plan and purpose. Don't give reluctantly or in response to pressure. Why? Because God loves a person who gives cheerfully. You get to cheerfully allocate your resources in a way so that you know you get to get in on God's best personally and help other people get in on God's best as well. Watch this. When you allocate your resources, your God-given resources, in a godly way to accomplish a godly purpose, you are investing in eternity. You get to invest in eternity. And yes, it pays dividends here, and it will pay dividends forever. So let me give you some examples. Let me show you some ways you can use your time, talent, and treasure here at Midtown Church. Okay, some of you have heard about our backpack ministry. Our backpack ministry is a ministry that feeds children, school children, on the weekends. Most all of these children are getting lunch and breakfast at school, but on the weekends they're not. A lot of them are going hungry. Did you know that one out of every four children in Arkansas goes hungry? One out of four. I suspect after the pandemonium of the pandemic, it's worse than that. But one out of four in our community. So we have the opportunity. We call it the backpack ministry because when we started it, back when we started the church, we literally put food in backpacks, okay? Breakfast, lunch, and dinner, and a snack for Saturday and Sunday. But the kids are kind of getting made fun of for that. So now we just put them in a bag, and the school distributes them in a nice way so that kids don't get made fun of. The last time I checked, it was about a year or so ago, on the impact of our ministry, the backpack ministry. I was told we were serving about 380 children. This year, the new numbers are in, and you're going to be shocked. Put this on the screen, okay? It says 450. Guys, it's close to 500 children that we serve. You can give God a hand for that if you'd like. Right on. 500 and almost 20 schools. That's an incredible ministry that we have to our community, okay? Now, how can you be involved? Good question. You can be involved with your time by volunteering. During this service on Sundays, there is a team of people back in our backpack ministry room right now who are moving and sorting and unboxing stuff that come from Sam's and these different places. We need some strong hands and arms and backs, okay? I started to say strong men, but I know some of you women are strong too, okay? So we're an equal opportunity whatever. If you can do that during this service or on Tuesday afternoons, that's a great way to volunteer your time to help with that. You can give of your talent, again, your strength. Maybe you can drive, you can deliver the food, or you can go do some shopping for us. You can give of your treasure by donating food. Now remember, we only want food that's on the list. You can find that on our website. Or donating financially. Watch this. $25 will feed one kid for a whole month. $25 to feed one kid for a whole month. Perfect way for to use your time, talent, and treasure to accomplish God's purpose through that great ministry. Here's another one, okay? Our student ministry, led by our student ministry's pastor, Aaron Sexton. Watch this.
Hey everyone, my name is Aaron Sexton, and I'm the student ministry's pastor here at Midtown Church, and I'm here to ask you guys for some help. God has been doing some really cool things in the student ministry, and we've grown bigger and faster than we ever expected coming out of the pandemic. But that's left us with a really good problem. We need more adults to help us lead students to find and experience God's best on Wednesday nights. And I know that sounds scary because you're thinking, man, I really don't want to teach junior high and high school students. And I totally get it. It's awkward and intimidating trying to teach junior high and high school students. But I don't need you to teach. I have lots of other areas that you can serve that are way less scary than teaching.
We have small groups full of guys and girls that need caring adults to invest in them. In these groups, you focus on getting to know each other and God through personal relationships, and everyone is given a set of questions to guide them in doing that. There's no teaching or curriculum involved. We just want you to invest in students so they can find and experience God's best. We also need help making sure students are welcomed, checked in, and supervised for safety every week. This doesn't require much more than a smile and a good attitude, and it's the best way to make new students feel comfortable when they show up for the first time. Another area we could use help in is in social media. We like to have a good time, and we want to show students how much fun we have when we're together, but right now we don't have anybody to document that for us. All this person needs to do is be handy with their phone and willing to take photos and videos of what we do on Wednesday nights.
There's lots of other ways that you can be involved too, like helping with the games on Wednesday nights, or joining our AV team, and a whole lot more. So make sure, if you're interested, that you check the box on the back of your connection card so that we can get you all the information you need to use your gifts to help us lead students find and experience God's best on Wednesday night. I hope that you will prayerfully consider joining us, and I can't wait for you to be a part of our team.
There's a great way, an opportunity to use your time by being a volunteer, your talent, maybe you're handy with social media or crafts or games or things like that, or your treasure. By consistently giving to our church, you're using your treasure to help that ministry. And then occasionally when there's special events, offering scholarships and that kind of deal. What about our children's ministry? Same thing. You can use your time by volunteering on Wednesday night or on Sunday morning. You can use your talent. Maybe you are good with arts and crafts or with music or things like that. You can use your treasure. Again, when you consistently give to our church, to our offering, you're funding that ministry. And then from time to time, there are special needs that come along as well that you can help fund. What about our neighborhood groups? Our neighborhood groups is our small group ministry for adults. Listen, we need new groups. Josh, our connections pastor, was telling me, we have people that want to be in a group and we don't have any groups to put them in. So maybe you're thinking, I'd like to be in a group too. The best, most successful groups we have are when people just like you get two or three or four of their friends or two or three or four of their couple friends and say, hey, let's get together. We're doing life together anyway. Let's do one of these Bible things together. It's super easy. You can give of your time by hosting a group, by facilitating a group, by just being in a group. You can give of your talent by facilitating. If you're good at asking questions and help people follow along. And you don't have to teach, by the way, okay? Most of these are video-driven. It's really simple to do. Maybe you're good at organizing events, and so you could, in your neighborhood group, you could organize fun things to do outside of your group. Maybe you like hosting and being hospitality and the whole cooking thing, and you could do the snacks for your group. I don't know, whatever it is. Or you could provide financially for our group, for your group, by helping when needs come up in those groups and being consistently giving to our church as well. What about our creative worship technical ministry? You can give your time by being a volunteer on Sunday and at rehearsal on Wednesday night. You can give of your talent. If you play an instrument that could be in our band, or you are good with sound or lighting or the production of the technical stuff. You can give of your treasure when you consistently give to the church. But then also, we always have equipment upgrades we need to do, or something broke, or this or that, or whatever, and we need some little extra help financially with those things. And again, if you have any questions about those, you can talk to Carol, who leads that ministry. Now listen, there are tons and tons and tons of other ministries. Our men's ministry, our women's ministry, there's all kinds of things going on, okay? Celebrate Recovery, lots of different ways that you can invest your time, talent, and treasure. And so here's what I want to ask you to do. Will you pray and ask God to show you how He wants you to invest here at Midtown Church? How He wants you to invest your resources in a way that accomplishes His plan and purpose through this church? I guarantee you, that's a prayer God will answer. And when you do, when He does, then you will use your resources in a way that honors and glorifies Him, and you get to experience His best as well. So let's wrap it up today, guys, by asking the big question we ask every week. And what's our big question? Come on. If you're new today, we like to ask, well, so what? Well, what do I do with that? How does that impact my life? What am I supposed to walk out of here with? Great question. Thank you. Here's our memory verse for this week. We're going to go back and look at verse 21 of chapter 25 of Matthew. Look what it says. The master was full of praise. Well done, my good and faithful servant. You've been faithful in handling this small amount, so now I will give you many more responsibilities. Let's celebrate together. God wants to celebrate with you as you use your resources for His glory. He will. He will celebrate with you. He will honor you. He will bless you for doing that. So here's your so what. I want you to write this down. You ready? When I use my resources the way God intended, my blessings increase and I am commended. God says, I want to bless you. Does that mean you're going to have more money, more stuff, more time? Yeah, maybe, maybe not. But you will be blessed in those things. You will experience God's best in those things. He will honor your faithful obedience to Him. Remember this. It's not about getting more stuff. It's about using what you have for His glory. Does that make sense to you guys? Let me say it again, because some of you are still writing, and that's fine. Take your time. Listen, it's not about getting more stuff. It's about using your stuff for God's glory. Now, before you tune out on Facebook, before you tune out here in the building, listen, look at me. I'm going to tell you a cool story. I'm going to tell you a really, really cool story. True story, not a preacher's story. This really happened. This past week, I had a text conversation with a single mom in our church, as a single mom of two guys. And I just wrote her and just encouraging her and this and that, and yada, yada, yada. The next day, she wrote me back, said, I'm so sorry to bother you, but I had to tell you this. We got a raise at work today. And I'm like, that's fantastic. That is super duper awesome. She said, we got a raise today, and I know it's all because of God, and I'm so excited and so thankful, or something like that. Now, Some of you have had these conversations with me. You tell me something that God did in your life, and I start questioning you about it, you know, okay? And so I did this with her. I said, bear with me for a moment. Here comes Curious Pastor. And I do this to help us understand a little more about how God operates in our lives. So go with me. I said, you are very quick to say God erased, but you very quickly gave God credit for that. Why? Why did you give God credit for you getting a raise? Here was her response. This is so good. She said, because all of us are doing our best to walk with Him. We are not perfect, but my boys, as young men, are trying to stay above the fray and make God a priority. And I believe that our faith in Him, although I worry sometimes, He knows my heart. He sees that. And then here's the part I want you to get. Listen to this. I don't see it, God's blessings in her life, God's answering her prayers in her life, God leading her to His best. I don't see these blessings in my life, ready? I don't see it as a reward, but as what He promises if we have faith. That's good stuff. I wish I'd said that. It's not a reward, it's a result of our faith in God. And Him being true to His promises. God says, I've given you these resources. Use them for my glory, to accomplish my purpose. And when that happens, you'll experience my best. So what are you going to do? What are you going to do with your resources? How does what you've heard today from God's word change the way you think about your resources? And how is that going to translate now into the way you use them? I'm going to ask you to do me a favor. Grab your connection card, okay? Flip it over on the back. Let me show you something. If you're joining us online, click the Connect tab on our website, scroll down to the bottom, and find the thing that says My Personal So What. This is a way for you to say, okay, we saw the so what in the service, but how does that apply to me personally? Remember, we don't share this with anybody but our staff. We don't email this out of the room. And we just want to help you. So I want to encourage you. It says this week, I will use my resources for God's glory by. Maybe you're going to start using your time in volunteering in one of the ministries we mentioned or some other ministry that we have. Maybe you're going to begin using your talent in a way that contributes to accomplishing God's purpose, growing His church. Maybe you're going to start giving financially to God. Or maybe you're going to increase what you've been giving financially to God. I don't know what it is for you, and that's okay. But here's what I want to encourage you to do. You must each decide in your own heart how much to give of your resources. Will you pray with me? Will you ask God to show you what He wants to do? And then when you faithfully obey Him and trust Him to bless that, you ready? Let's do that together. God, thank You so much today for teaching us about resources. Thank You for the way You've blessed us. Thank You for the things that You've given us. Thank You, God, for the resources we have. And I pray, Father, that we today would make a decision because of our devotion to You, that we would be more disciplined in the allocation of our resources for Your glory. God, I pray that You would bless families, marriages, single adults, students. That, Father, we would not be afraid, that we would step out in faith, knowing that You will honor our faithful obedience to You. And God, I do pray that if there's anybody listening right now online or anybody who's in this room who has never truly put their faith in Jesus and received the greatest blessing of all through Him, that today Your Spirit would draw them, that they would put their faith in Jesus today so that we can then get in on the best that You've given us for Your glory. Thank You, God, for blessing us. May we bless others as a blessing to You for Your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hey guys, thank you so much for listening so well today. I want to ask you to hold tight for just a second longer, okay? Because our connections pastor, Josh, has a couple of things to say before we go. Josh?
Awesome. Thanks, Doug. Yeah, you'll notice on the back of your connection card there at the bottom, it says my decision today. Maybe some of you for the first time, as Doug just prayed, you gave your life to Jesus. Let us know that on the back of your connection card. Check any of those boxes that apply to you so that one of our pastors can follow up with you this week and encourage you in the decision you made today. Those of you online, you can do the same thing on your online connection card. Well, if our volunteers would please make your way to your places, don't forget, drop your two offering envelopes and your connection card in one of the baskets in the back of the room. First-time guests, hold on to your card, take it to that table where you picked up your worship guide, and we'll give you a gift as you go. So glad you guys were here today. You're dismissed. Have a great day.